We are in Rhythm. We are a product consultancy. If you guys are looking for, we do work in Java, JavaScript, UX. So if you guys are looking for opportunities, we're hiring. That's good news. And we do this monthly, right? And we have this event partially because one of our core values is around learning and growth. It's one of the things that we really strongly believe in is when you come to InRhythm, not only do you get great experience working on a variety of different clients, but you also get an opportunity to learn and grow. So a lot of our speakers that we have are our own InRhythm engineers. One of the questions that I ask everybody that comes to the door is, what is one thing you want to learn and what is one thing you want to teach, right? So it's a continuous journey. And so I hope you enjoy this talk. James Woods is probably one of our most senior engineers. He is multifaceted, along with being not only a very good full stack engineer, he's also a fifth entrepreneur. He's helping InRhythm build our business. He has a pretty colorful background and has, I think, a very interesting conference. So please put your hands together and welcome James.
I want to do something a little bit differently. I'm assuming everyone here has developed before, knows what React is, has heard of React Native, maybe not built anything React Native, but knows something about it. So I'm going to kind of go over, just kind of give you a brief overview of exactly what I'm going to go over. I'm going to go over the basics of React and React Native in general, and exactly how that correlates to the native application versus like the pros and cons. And then I'm actually at the end going to kind of go through a code example that I built that's a little different than the to-do apps and the hello worlds, where everyone knows how React Native eventually is going. It's supposed to, it doesn't really compile down to native code, but it works over what's called a bridge to work with either platform. So it's the right ones, works everywhere type of ideology. So I'm going to show you exactly how past just writing the JavaScript code, how you can actually create your own components in Swift and in Java, and actually how they connect to the actual React Native application that you're building in JavaScript. So, kind of tied with React Native, but not so obvious, because some of the things I'm going to speak to are not going to be the things that you're going to find on the React Native site. So, React Native at a glance, I'm going to go kind of first just kind of review everything. So what do you need to know to kind of develop in React or React Native to begin with? ES6 features is not a must, but it will make your life a lot simpler. Destructuring, there's a lot of different paradigms in React Native that's gonna make your life a lot easier. The React JS component, APIs, and lifecycles. Setting up a dev environment, and I also have examples of each one of these I'm gonna go through. Typo is supposed to be state management, not statement management. When it comes to React Native, I recommend there's a system called Apollo that was created by Meteor. Makes life a lot easier. I'm going to go into detail about that. There's another, I won't say competitor, but it was actually built by Facebook called Relay. Good luck. I can't help you with that. I've looked at the code. It's really a huge learning curve. It's faster than Apollo, but it's a lot harder to work with. Then GraphQL, in my opinion, for the win, when working with React Native. So GraphQL has its purposes, pros and cons, yeah. And then Flexbox, yes, Flexbox. When you're working in web development, most people have heard of Flexbox. In React Native, that's how you style everything. You can have your other, styles like colors and backgrounds and borders and things like that. But in Flexbox, it's going to be a little, that is the say-all, do-all on how you can write your code once and it'll format to a degree on an iPad or an iPhone or the 750 plus versions of Android. Because if you try to do it, anyone working on our website response would be very difficult. Flexbox makes that right. So, React APIs and lifecycles, I'm just going to kind of open this up just to kind of over. Type level APIs, I would highly recommend. If the thing about React and React Native, I'm going to go into a different slide, it's kind of in two parts. There's React that everyone knows about, that's the functionality, the framework, the library, and then there's what's called a this top-level API kind of goes over the non-renderer side, but the actual code that's specific to React. The renderer, I'm going to actually show you a page. You can actually use React to do React Sketch, React VR, React Native, React PDF, React, I think there's a list of like 20 or 30 different renderers that have been developed for React. So React isn't just for web and native, that is the main thing that people actually care about. And then state and lifecycle methods, learn it, love it, you're going to have to, because those are going to be the integral parts on how you can tell when an application is doing certain things, and you can make differences. You can, through your code, you can actually do different things based upon what state or what type of property that you're going to have. Dev environment. There are a lot of different out there. There's Sublime Text, there's Atom. My personal favorite is VS Code. I've worked in pretty much all of them. And I've worked in the ones made by IntelliJ, WebStorm. I've pretty much built in everything. VS Code, just in my opinion, is one of the better ones for JavaScript. You can use it for other things, Golang, Java, tons of plugins that can basically you can write with anything. But these are some of my favorite plugins, personally. React Native Tools is kind of an absolute must if you're going to be dealing with React Native. It's going to help you, kind of gives you some like highlighting, some IntelliSense in regards to predictive auto completing what you're writing. Babel, that's just JavaScript in general, because not everything is supported by every browser, so you need Babel to kind of transpile the stuff that you're working with. ESLint, make sure that ESLint to make sure that your code is up to par. There's a bunch of different things you can set up settings prettier. That's exactly what it sounds like, to make things look prettier. Even though I said I prefer VS Code over Atom, Atom does have key maps that make life a lot easier in regards to developing. So if you download the plugin and you're not too familiar with Atom Keymap, I would highly recommend just seeing some of the shortcuts. That makes things a little easier to get done. Color highlighting, working with a large file, sometimes if everything is black, it makes it a little difficult to see, like, wait, where's this function start, where's it end, where's the curly braces. GitLens, thank you, Nick, for introducing to me that yesterday. Instead of having to go to Git and do like a rep log and figure out, so who wrote this horrible piece of code, you literally can just put the mouse over your code and it literally will show you, oh, that guy I need to talk to. So it'll give you kind of a history of every line of code. So if you have a question about what you're doing, if it's not like a public repo, but a team you're working on, it'll make it easier for you to figure out who did it so you can speak to them to see why. Auto imports, thank you, Nick. This one I love. It can auto import allows you where when you're typing in a function name or any kind of component in the page, instead of having to remember, wait, where is that file in my tree? You literally auto import will kind of highlight and give you the name of whatever you type in if you type it, and when you click it, it will automatically add that import in the top. So it just makes it a lot easier to do certain things. Rainbow Brackets, Code Spell Checker is another little small one. It kind of helps you on different things, like if you write function F-U-C-N-T-I-O and it'll underline in green. So it'll help save you a lot of time with like simple typos. Apollo and Great GraphQL. A little history on, go over Apollo first. Apollo is built by a company called GraphQL. Apollo makes it very easy to grab the information from like your GraphQL service. You can use Apollo for other things, but GraphQL is like really known for. And it has a lot of different components for like caching, for a store. And it's very specialized for mobile development, but you can use it for web. GraphQL is another server, I don't want to go too much into it. It was kind of developed by Facebook for the sole purpose of mobile. When you work with a company that size, I worked on projects where I would get a response from the backend server. Perfect example, I had a 30,000 line response, and the only thing I needed was an image URL, a title, and it was like, and it was a couple other things. It was like maybe 5 or 6 things, so I literally had to command F. Luckily, if I remember what the key value was, and I'd sit there and just scroll for days, and I'm like, why do I need this entire file if the only thing I need is these different pieces? Well, when you're dealing with mobile development, React Native, if you have that massive response, that's over somebody's, if they're not on Wi-Fi, that's on someone's cellular net. So the larger the amount of response, they have to download that. I know we have 4G and LTE and whatever else, but that's a lot of data that's coming on. If you don't have unlimited Wi-Fi, unlimited data, then that can kind of hurt on your bill. It can take a little bit longer to download. So what GraphQL does is you literally can add which keys you specifically need. So there's some cons to it in regards to it is a wrapper over your server. So it's slower, but it's so minimal when you're talking about native that you don't even notice the difference. In a desktop application, I don't always recommend it because it does have other cons that can kind of play in a part. But GraphQL, their main purpose is you can get the response you want. So all I need is an image URL, a title of a button, or like simple text. I literally can write, it's in a JSON format, I want this, this, and this. And that's the only thing I'll get. So it speeds up the responses that you get from the server so that your page can go live. Layout is king. All layout in React Native, like I said before, is Flexbox. I'm not gonna go too much into Flexbox. I have this link afterwards. I'll speak to Brianna to try to get like this, these slides. So I have links to all the references I'm gonna talk to. There's a thing in React Native called style sheet. It's an object that a function that functionality comes from React Native, and there's a function called create. Create takes, create actually takes a JSON object of the style that you're going to create, and it creates a literal style sheet object, and it allows you to start referring by an ID instead of the actual full object. The thing about React Native is, when you work in iOS, Swift, Kotlin, Java, it compiles down specifically to the code for that specific platform. React Native doesn't compile down to it. It actually connects to the API on those different services, on those different web languages, and it goes over what's called a bridge. So when it goes over that bridge from your JavaScript code to the actual platform code, it's called crossing the bridge. It is very, very, very expensive. So the larger the style sheet or the larger the function, whatever that you have to pass over that bridge, the slower your application can be. So there are some differences. If you start really getting comfortable with React Native, you'll start to see there are some speed differences, but in most cases, you won't even notice it. So what happens with the create, it creates that style sheet, it passes over the bridge one time, and then from that point on, it only is going to reference it by the ID, so it's a lot quicker. Whereas if you were to create the style by itself, every time you loaded that page, it will literally pass that through the bridge, and every single time, it will just pass it through the bridge. That can slow down the app, especially if you're doing like an animation or anything like that. So what exactly is React Native? React Native versus native. So the goods. React Native, especially the JavaScript developers, is a lot more familiar for people. You have JavaScript and JSX, which is like an XML type format. So if you know HTML, it makes it a lot simpler. React Native is gonna be a little bit different than React is going to be, just for the simple fact is, in HTML, like HTML5, you have different tags, nav, div, h1. Well, in React Native, they don't have that. They have components that I'm gonna go over later, like view. And then view is gonna connect to like the UI view in Android, and like another view and UI view in iOS, and then another view in Android. React, like I was saying before, is React Native is actually a framework. Everything is kind of built into React Native. Whereas with React, this is a long debate, but it is a library, it's not a framework. If you don't know the difference, a framework is everything included. A library is, in this case, React is just a view, but if you need anything else, you have to import it in. You gotta import the state management, you gotta import all these different other functionalities, routing. So if you were working like, say, Angular, it would come with routing. If you do a React, you have to bring that in. You have to bring, so all those other different components you have to bring in, so that's what constitutes a library. React Native, everything is included within it, so it's technically a framework. Flexbox is found, and also React Native comes with a lot of widgets and animations. I'm actually gonna go to the site and go through that also. These widgets make it easier for you to create certain components so you don't have to build them out yourself. So for instance, in a web, you need to create a button. You can create a button and add all the styles. There's actually a button tag, a button component in React. There's a thing called a list view. If you want to make a list, you can just pass like a data object, and it'll literally list it out in a, actually not supposed to use list view anymore. Flat list and section list. They're trying to deprecate this. I've done that also. Then the user interface constructed consisted of native widgets. So you add those components one time, and at one time, and then it'll basically, depending on what platform it is, it'll point to that specific mapping of the component on that specific platform. And it's learn once and write anywhere. So the bad, there are API restrictions. That was another reason I wanted to go a little bit differently and show you how you can create code on the native side and link it to the JavaScript side. It's rare in most cases, everything that you can think about building, you can pretty much do in React Native, but there are going to be certain things, like if you want to get into like DAR and that type of thing, you're gonna have to build it in iOS. There's no way around it. So there are some API restrictions depending on what you're looking to build. Complex designs. In iOS and Android, I mean, they have the builders where you can kind of, you know, there's Xcode and there's a interface builder where you can actually build the components out. So it kind of takes, some people who are experienced like to do it from the ground up and code every little button and piece. But some people actually like to, okay, let me take the UID, put it in the page, and then kind of draw lines and connect everything together. So you have that, you can go either route when you're doing native. Native, but when you're dealing with React Native, you literally have to just build out all the different pieces. But if you're familiar with React or JavaScript or HTML, it's pretty quick. And it is a slow performance. In most cases, it's not going to be noticeable depending on what you're doing. But if you're talking about like high CPU, GPU intensive calculated, like that type of thing, animations, it's not a noticeable difference, but depending on the size of the application, it could be noticeable. And on the native side, Android, you're looking at Java, Kotlin, iOS, you got Swift, Objective-C. Obviously, there's no API restrictions. Whatever your mind can think of, there's probably something somewhere in the code in Xcode or in iOS that you can build that stuff out. And the long-term benefits, stability. Yes, they have APIs that are going to be restricted or deprecated over time, but pretty much it's pretty stable. Now, let me explain this learn once, rewrite parts of it next year. If you've ever done iOS development, every year around the fall, you're going to get, in this case, you're going to get iOS 13. Developers, we're going to get iOS 13 in like May or June. But a simple fact, stuff is going to break. Because iOS likes to, they tell you they're going to deprecate it a year or two in advance, but it's up to you to not be lazy and actually change it for the new version that's going to come out. If you don't, if you did something in iOS 11 and that function isn't there anymore when iOS 13 comes, you're gonna have to rewrite a large portion of it. So they give you some time to prep for it, but at the same time, there is a chance every year you might have to rewrite part of your code just because it's just not gonna work anymore. You have to build an application for each platform. So if you have a company and you want to build like the next latest and greatest application, if you're doing native, you have to have one code base for your Android, and you have to have one code base for your iPhone. There's no way around it. And hopefully you have someone who's like dual platform that can code in both languages, but in most cases it's gonna be you specialize in one and you specialize in another. Where in React Native you can kind of code it once. And there's some styling differences, you know, iOS sometimes you have buttons at the bottom, Android at the top, whatever it is, but there are some differences. Layouts. So in React Native, the things you won't know about CSS, JSS, XML format, Flexbox with styling, and there's also like the native components that help you lay out a lot of the tools that you're doing. You have your text, so anytime you write text, if you're in a browser put it to the site, it will work like you expect. If I say hello world, the browser will say hello world. If you go in React Native and you type hello world and you do not put it in the text box, it will not compile. So anytime you protect, you have to do text input, same thing, you have to put it in the text input. Views, you can kind of look at as divs. They're like link tags, but everything has to be contained in them. Or in React, you can use a React fragment. But if you don't have, if you have a bunch of code, you have to put it in a div or in React fragment. Same thing, or it won't compile. It has to be all in one wrapping div and images. On the native side, Android, most of your layout's gonna be in XML. And then there's like a thing called constraint layout. And on the iOS side, there's storyboards where you can kind of drag stuff around and kind of position it, put constraints on it. And then there's other things, stack view, there's auto layout. I put question marks because it depends on which one you're more comfortable with. iOS gives you a lot of different options on how to style. Some people prefer one or the other, it's up to you. Interface builders kind of go back to the storyboard, and constraints and question markers every year they come out with something new. So Xcode, like I said, definitely changes. Components. So each one of the platforms have different components that help you in the development process. You have your components, which everyone knows the term component, but if you go into like iOS and Android, no one's really going to say that term. So this is kind of just like a breakdown of the component terms, and also there's a thing called lifecycle methods. I went over before. If you know React, there's a lifecycle methods, component get around, the renders, the ship component update, component get around, all those different versions. And then there's actually what's called re-render on state changes. iOS and Android have something very similar, they just use different terminology. On the Android side, when you talk about the lifecycle methods, when I try to explain it, I just tell people to think of it like a media player. On create, on start, on resume, on pause, on stop, on restart, and then like on destroy. So some of them a little off, but pretty much it's a media player when you talk about the lifecycle methods. On native side, they can get complicated. I put the dots because there's a lot more. I don't know why most of these I've probably never used, but there are cases if you're working on like an advanced project. So when you're looking at React Native, you have the render function that actually is going to display what you want onto the page. In Native, you have a UI view. If you want to do it programmatically, you can draw rect so that you have super control, but you never really want to call draw rect. That's kind of like you never call render. Set content view, same thing on Android. That's the function that actually, so you can access the layout file that will create the code, but you're never really going to call those functions. It's something that's kind of generated through your logic. And then same thing, each one has renderers. Native, iOS and Android have like listeners and observables, so we can kind of tell when things change or re-render. On the native side, they call it redraw, but it's basically re-render, same term. So here's the React Native component mapping. So you have a view manager on Android, you have an RCT view manager on iOS. This is where the views kind of come into play. So on a native module that maps a JSX view to the native views as the view tags. So the view in Android is going to map to a UI view in iOS, and I can't remember what the, I can't even remember what it is on Android, but there is a different component that invokes the new text view in case you're on Android. So on the native module, you have your Android, I took a picture and it's called Android. Android and iOS. And then those are going to be in Java and also Kotlin, Objective-C and Swift. And then there's this thing I was talking about, the React Native Bridge. The bridge is how you connect your JavaScript code to the actual native code. So that part is actually written in Java and C++. So the React Native Bridge isn't written in the languages for the platform. And then you have the JavaScript virtual machine on the JavaScript core. That's actually what it's written in on your application side when it compiles down. I had it at the bottom of the screen. The UI view and Android out view, and the NS attribute strings, manual strings. So this is kind of what I was talking about, the React core and React renderer. So just so you have a better idea what I'm, these are all, most of the renderers that React has. React A-Frame, ARC, LESS, DOM, DOM server, React streaming, hardware. Like most people don't even know that most of these even exist. React worker down, different renderers. So there's the React, which is actually the code, the lifecycle methods, that's across all React, anything are always going to be the same. Nothing's going to change. You're always going to have a render function, you're always going to have the lifecycle method, you're always going to have those different components. Then when you get to the specific platform, there's a thing that's what's actually going to render what you're writing into whatever platform is going to go to the render. So in the case of React Native, we have all these different components. There's a view, there's a text, image, text, and view, there's a scroll view, there's a style sheet, there's buttons, there's a bunch of different buttons, there's pickers, sliders, switches, flat list. It used to be a list view, but they changed it out, so now it's a flat list, section list, and go, there's on and on and on. If you go to, I think it's this one. Yeah, so these are some of the basic components. These are user interface, list views, iOS component APIs, Android specific ones, then there's others. And then when you click on each one of these, then they'll give you a lot more details of the props and the functionality and everything that comes with it. So React Native conversions. Everything that you're going to write in your code is going to convert to a specific primitive on the native side. So the string, inner string, floats, doubles. iOS doesn't really have a float or a double. It's an inner string for pretty much all of it. Boolean. You can kind of see the mapping of the names, but these are pretty much going to be NS dictionary. It's the same thing as a key value store. And then if you want to send like a function, it's called a response and clock. The native component bridge. Would you want to walk over this across this bridge? The reason I'm saying that is you want to go across a bridge as seldom as possible. Whatever, if you don't need to do functionality for the native side, don't, because that's when you start seeing the slowdowns. So if you want to do like certain animations, that type of thing, it's better to do it on the React side than having to call functionality on the platform side. So there's only way across. So now I'm going to actually show some examples, but I'm just going to go over the actual format of what you need to do to actually create the bridge between your JavaScript code and the actual native code. So on the iOS side, when you go into Xcode and create a new file, do it on here, you already created a bridge. You only have one bridge, that's actually this file. And this bridge is, sorry. Okay. Yeah, I forgot, this was actually the demo that I was creating, so it actually already has the bridge file. So what happens is when you create a file, it's gonna ask you if you wanna actually create a bridge. And you click on it, it's going to create this, the name of the file that you created. So in this case, it was the RN Tech Talk, and then it'll put bridge in the header. So inside of that header, that's when you're going to put all your imports that you would need to connect your native code to the JavaScript code. On the Android side, it's a little different. You don't have to build the bridge header, it's kind of already built in. Then what you want to do is create a variable and a function in the JS.
Is there any way you can change the background color to white or something later?
I don't know how to do it. You don't need to change the background color? I've always used this color.
You have to change your theme.
Like preferences at the top?
Much easier to read. Thank you.
Yeah, that. Definitely change that after the presentation. So on the app side, then this will make a little more sense. So there's this one in particular here, is the main one, is the native module. We're going to link to that React Native that I had in the bridge to this. Then you will create React component is like you normally would. You have your state, you know, and then you have your functions. So when you want to create the code on the Android or iOS side, you call me native modules, and then in this case it's Circuit Breaker, which is that actual class on the server side. So in my iOS, I actually have a file called Circuit Breaker, and on the Android side, I actually have a file called Circuit Breaker. So it's native modules dot whatever the class name is, and then whatever the name of the function on the server side, which I'm going to show you also. So you do the same thing, turn on, this update, and then the update, there's a thing called git status. There's a callback on the server side, on the platform side that I'm going to go over also. And then you would just build it out like you normally would a regular component. You have your text, your conditional, this press. And this is what I was talking about, the style sheet.create. Just so, I guess, an aside, all of the style sheets that you're kind of used to in HTML, this thing is the exact same thing in React Native, it just can't paste. But you can't, it's an object, so you can't really put the name of the file. So in HTML, you would put background hyphen color, and React Native, you just put background, get rid of the hyphen, makes you have a lot of good candidates. And that's for everything, padding right, justify content align items. Instead of putting the first word hyphen in another word, you just make everything count case, and it's literally all the CSS you use to make. Then there's create connection in Swift. So I create, there's actually two files you need to create. So you have the Circuit Breaker Swift. Now this is there's a tag called at Objective-C. That is what opens up your native code to your actual JavaScript code. So any function, any variable, anything that you want on the platform side, you literally just put at Objective-C, and then it'll know that that's what you want to actually be able to link to inside of. It'll map directly to these. And then turn on, turn off, git status. These are the ones, git status, turn on, turn off. And then you have the same functionality, a circuit breaker with the name of the class, and then that variable name, whatever you want to do. And then whatever the function is, you have to have one function as a callback. This callback is actually what's going to actually send that information back when you to fire that event. And then the .m file is actually. And then this is the interface. There's two files. There's one that actually has a logic of what you want to do. And then there's the other file that actually is the interface of what functionality you want to assign. So you have the names here. If you know like Java or any of those type languages or any other, like strongly typed languages that have interfaces, or even TypeScript and JavaScript. This is the interface of all the functionality that you want, the contracts that you want to have with the JavaScript side. So if it's a method, then you would have turn on, turn off, and then get status. And then the module is the name of the class, and then you just have to make it in as object. So this code is actually firing, so it's actually this code is actually firing off asynchronously to the platform side, and these are the. This is actually just a console log that I'll automatically give you inside of the text. Now, just to kind of go over the Android side, it's going to look extremely similar. It just you don't have to create the bridge. It's the exact same thing, but instead of putting the at Objective-C in Java, you would have the at React method. But outside of that, if you look at the code, it looks extremely similar. You just have the name of the circuit breaker of the class, so it'll be data modules, dot class, dot whatever function. So it's literally exactly the same. So this you deal, when you extend in Java, that function usually has some type of contract or a certain method you have to override, just because the git name is literally just returns the name that you want to pass of whatever the class is. So I could have named this whatever I wanted, because you're never really going to use it, but you have to override it, just, or it won't compile. So if you go into the Android side, there's a button here. I don't know why it only like an increase when I increase the size of the page.
Could you turn it horizontal and turn it back if I didn't draw?
Oh, there it is. Thank you.
Yeah.
So literally,
saving app with Flutter.
Oh, and Flutter, just aside, Flutter is actually, Google's. So Flutter is actually written in Dart. Flutter actually compiles down to native code. My only gripe with Flutter, I love it. I've had some conversations with Google about some things, but Flutter is more on the material design, so it's a little harder, it makes it a little harder to get a custom look and feel rather than like a React Native, you can make it whatever you want. So if you're fine with the material design, Flutter is faster. It's beautiful if you're into the material design. So in that case, I definitely recommend just take a look at it. Those are the two main competitors, Flutter and React Native. And if you know, like Java, JavaScript, Dart's actually pretty quick to pick up.
And would you be able to do cross-platform development using Flutter without having to do it twice?
No, it's the same thing. Yeah, just like React Native. So you build it once and it'll compile down. It's just you're not going over break. It's literally compiling down to the actual language.
Okay.
Yeah. So. Because JavaScript really isn't like a compile type language, Dart is. This create native modules. There was something I actually put in here, y'all didn't see it because I took it out. React components, this is kind of a random side, is only on iOS side. The React Native Threads is across, but what you have to do on the iOS side is just specifically for iOS. So there's actually three threads when you're dealing with React Native. There's the main thread, that would be like the UI kit. UI kit is kind of like a class that gives you all the functionality in iOS. Then you have the shadow queue, it's actually where all the layout's actually done. And then you have the JavaScript thread, is where your code actually runs. So every native module has a GCE queue, so basically what that means. The native module and your JavaScript code actually runs on different threads, basically what it means. So the issue with that is when you're running your code or debugging, if you don't add this line, you need to make our code run, you have to make your code run on the main queue, or there's gonna be like this yellow bar pop up that's gonna keep telling you, you wanna write this line of code to stop showing this. It'll let you know that they're running on different threads so that you can actually run this piece of code and kind of this helps with debugging. So it's kind of my talk. Did anyone have any specific questions? If you have questions, I have answers. Yes, Joe?
So when it comes to building for a device, like all the hardware, like all the like little things with the hardware, like for Apple, like it's 3D touch, it's Face ID, it's the size of the phone for like screen size, it's better to develop in native for that because most of those toolkits are pre-built into it, like in Swift, or is it, can you still achieve the same like experience in React Native?
Anything that you can do in iOS or Android, you can do React Native. So basically what happens is there's an API, mostly, there's an API for everything that you want to do on a specific platform. So when you're writing your JavaScript code, you're literally just calling that function on the iOS side. So just imagine you're literally coding in Swift. It is instead of specifically writing a Swift language, you're writing in JavaScript, and JavaScript is making the call to that function on the native side. That's what that bridge is.
Is it called gestures? Right?
Yeah, gestures. Yeah, yeah. So there's, when you work with React Native, you're going to see that error a lot. Gestures.
Since React Native, I guess, is, you would say it has a lot of ties to JavaScript, would you take, and well, ties to JavaScript is also ties to, I think, web technologies in general. So earlier, we were talking about animations. Would, if I was doing React Native, would I just take the liberty of building an SVG file and managing the state rather than, you know, writing a custom animation in JSX or something like that? I might as well just throw
There's actually a lot of animation libraries that link into the iOS side, or you can create animation through the CSS, oh, not through the CSS, through the JavaScript.
Mm-hmm.
So either one, either it's going to be fast, you know, CSS animation is always going to be a little bit faster. Animations are slightly slower than they are going to be in native. It's instead of, I think, on native, it's might be like a 5 or 10 frame per second, so it's not something that's super noticeable. But
something like you, instead of me writing in JSX, I just write it in SVG.
Oh, no, absolutely.
Yeah,
absolutely. There's actually a thing, I think it was in here, art. Yeah, art. But this is actually React art, like a different thing, but there's actually a art library specifically React Native. So you can actually create those animations and draw them wherever you want.
Okay, when you say it's not noticeable, is it not noticeable on the most recent device, or would that tear back down to like the older devices too? Like, even though it'll still be slower on an older device, regardless of platform, like, is it way more noticeable? Like,
no.
Oh, okay.
No, absolutely not. The only reason I'm saying noticeable, like when I'm developing,
yeah.
I'm a dev.
Yeah.
So I'm specifically looking at it like, stopping on this code. Like I didn't see it,
yeah.
But if like my mom's like, oh wow, this is really cool, she's not even noticed. Any other questions?
I have a question.
Yeah, sure.
How can I start to learn React Native? Are there any resources that
That's one thing that I will give Facebook. There's this Get Started. This is actually the official homepage of React. If you're not too shy about spending 10, 12 bucks, there's a guy I highly recommend, Steven Greider. Oh, I've actually hired people that when I saw their code, I was like, this looks oddly familiar. I was like, can I interview this guy? And he was like, yeah. And I'm speaking to him. I said, your code seemed a little bit too perfect. Let's kind of go through your code. And I was going through the code. I was like, have you ever heard of Steven Greider? Dude, that's my man. I was like, yeah, you're definitely in here. But there's a guy, Steven Greider, for JavaScript, I highly recommend.
Would that be Udemy?
And Steven Greider has I have like 150 some courses, so I've pretty much tried every 4 or 5 star JavaScript guy on Udemy. That guy, and there's another guy, Maximilian. Yeah, Maximilian and Steven Greider, in my opinion, are hands down my favorites. In regards to like extreme detail, starting from the basics, and actually going into detail things that you would actually use in production.
Their courses are so long.
Extremely. But the thing is, if you get through it, you'll definitely be a
It takes forever.
Well, if you go to like a Flatiron or a Codesmith or any of those schools, you're gonna put those same amount of hours in, a lot more. You're at Flatiron, right?
Mm-hmm.
You go to those schools, how many hours you put in?
Exactly.
So you can do that.
All of my hours. All of them.
So you can do that, or you can, I mean, their courses are what, 20 hours? I mean, no one's gonna sit there and go 8 hours a day and knock it out in 3 days, but you don't have to. If you stretch out 20 hours over, you know, 5-6 weeks, you're talking about an hour a day on your. You can get the app downloaded on your phone. You can watch it while you're on the train going to work. So, I mean, you can stretch it out. Because React, it's kind of like a marathon. You're not trying to figure out everything today.
So you're recommending these two guys, React Native?
If you're into videos, if you're into books, there's an in-action series I recommend to everyone. Name anything you could possibly think of, you just put in action at the end. React in action, Java in action.
Many books.
But yeah, anything in action. They're in layman's terms for people who may not be extremely senior, but they build you up to a point where you can get to like that level of knowledge.
So React Native in action.
Right, correct.
You mentioned like, you know, iOS, before they have a new release, they'll let the developers know, give them time to, you know, adjust their code base. I'm guessing you don't see that with React Native, like, because they kind of take care of that for you. But so how does that work with React Native versions?
React Native usually map more closely to React. So in React, you might have like 16.8. And React Native, it'll be like 0.60. So you just gotta have to map the version of React to like React Hooks actually just released in React Native on 16.8.5 or something like that. So you can actually use React Hooks in React Native now. So in that aspect, it's, if you follow along with React Native literally is about a month and a half behind the React versions.
So would you recommend Expo for beginners?
Expo for beginners, absolutely. But if you need, Expo is a phenomenal to start with, but if you ever need to do anything outside of like a basic application, then Expo can kind of hinder you. Like I've had issues, there's a thing, when you want to do something outside of just React, there's a thing called Expo Kit, where you have to eject your app into Expo Kit. So Expo Kit is, you can actually write into the native code. The only problem with that is sometimes when you're building stuff out, there'll be bugs, and if you're not like a hardcore developer, then you're going to spend a lot of time on Stack Overflow trying to debug those. So I actually started with Expo, and there was so many bugs that it was hindering my progress, because I would spend literally days, sometimes weeks on bugs, and then when I would find some random website in another country and translate it, and it would be the answer why I wasn't working. Oh, there's a bug in Expo. I'm like, I just spent 2 weeks for a bug I can't fix. So you have to wait for them to do it. One of the key functionalities for Expo is pushing, so you can push your code. So iOS doesn't stop. If you build an app in iOS, every time you actually go to deploy it, you have to go through the App Store. When you do through React Native, if you use Expo, and there's another one, I'll tell you what it is in a minute, which I use. You literally can write your JavaScript code, and inside of the code base, there's a link you have, where you would build whatever application you have, release that to iOS once, and anytime you need to make updates, you literally just would push that code to the server, and then it would just go to anyone who has the app when they upload it. So you don't have to keep redeploying and waiting a day or two for Apple to approve it. So what I use is a thing called CodePush by Microsoft. And CodePush has like CI/CD, it has a lot of it. You can actually, when you do the Git, it'll compile your code, deploy it, and push it. There's like staging environment. So if you have like test flight, you can actually push your stuff to staging. So say you want to push your code, but you don't want the entire population to have it yet, you can push it to the staging environment. And you can have like your own specific apps or hardware where you can test it, and then when you're ready, you can deploy it. So you're not affecting, you know, the live population. So it's called Microsoft CodePush. If you're using Expo specifically for like push notification or pushing your receiving code live to use it without having to go to the Apple Store again, I highly recommend CodePush. But Expo does give you a lot of stuff from the beginning, a lot of different components. But you can build all those on your own, and there's libraries, native base, React Native, Vectorize, there's tons of them if you Google them and just look at the GitHub stars. But if you're going to do anything outside of like a simple application, I don't recommend Expo, because you're going to have to eject, And the moment you eject it and go to having a new native code, there's no point having it code anymore. Does that make sense? Did that answer your question?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So I did use React before. I think around the time Firebase came out, so
okay.
There was a real tight relationship with that.
Yes.
So how is React with new developing maybe like authentication models? So you know, like Amazon Amplify. Does Facebook come up with libraries to work with Amplify, or are you like hitting up GitHub and just
the community
doing magic? Yeah.
Facebook isn't gonna give you anything except React. Anything outside of that, the thing is, that's one difference, like I say, between Dart and React Native. React Native has a massive following. If, trust me, if you look hard enough, somebody built a library for it. And it's probably got quite a few stars. Like for instance, iOS 13, I'm very happy about, it's finally allowing you to sign the NFC chips. So I was actually looking before, I actually found a module that did that. But you went and I found someone in the community that actually built one. It had a lot of stars and it worked perfectly. They decided to end up using it because Android allows you to sign NFC chips. iOS didn't until this year. So yeah, bottom line is anything you could possibly think of in regards to building, it's not going to come from Facebook. It's going to be from the community network. So just think of it like literally it's a library, and then you have to build the connector from the library.
Thank you.